For a split second after the universe was born, temperatures were 1,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000, 30 zeros, or roughly the number of paperclips equal to the mass of Jupiter. Before that, physics as we know it didn't exist. It was simply too hot. So hot that atoms hadn't yet formed. This temperature that the universe is thought to have been born into is called the Planck temperature. 142 nanillion degrees is way more than steamy. It's the temperature at which our understanding of physics breaks down, and in a way where it no longer makes sense to talk about temperature. Is there a limit to how hot or cold something can be? Turns out, at the extremes, physics gets freaky.
Freaky physics!
The Kelvin scale of temperature, named after Lord Kelvin, a Scottish scientist and inventor, is what scientists often calibrate their thermometers to. On this scale, room temperature, about 70 degrees Fahrenheit or 21 degrees Celsius, translates to 294 Kelvin. The lower limit of this scale was built to be okay. I mean, 0K. What I'm trying to say is zero would be absolute zero. What is absolute zero? Well, what we feel as temperature is the result of atoms zooming around and bouncing off of everything, including us. The faster their motion, the warmer the temperature. When this motion stops, you've reached absolute zero. Except you can't actually reach absolute zero. Quantum mechanics has this rule. We can't simultaneously know how fast something is moving and where it is, because even observing things, like with light or thermometers, changes a system just a little bit. So, if we could cool an atom to absolute zero, we would know exactly how fast it was going. Zero. And where it was, which isn't allowed. You can't have your quantum cake and eat it too.
Freaky physics!
Furthermore, the laws of thermodynamics say that the more heat you remove from a system, the harder it is to remove that next bit of heat, meaning it would be infinitely difficult to get out the very last bit of hot and reach ultimate cold. This is a concept named the unattainability principle. While absolute zero may be unachievable, scientists have been working to see how low we can go. In the late 1800s, scientists began liquefying gases like oxygen, hydrogen, nitrogen, and helium, and by 1908, Heike Kamerling Onnes, this guy, had liquefied helium down to 1.5 Kelvin, winning him a Nobel Prize. In 2016, scientists used lasers to squeeze atoms, reaching a low temperature of 360 millionths of a Kelvin. That's almost imperceptibly above absolute zero, and even lower than physicists once thought was possible. At these super low temperatures, verging on absolute zero, traditional physics gets a little
freaky.
We typically think of atoms as dispersed, like in a cloud, acting like individual particles. But when matter gets very cold, close to absolute zero, those atoms begin to behave together, more like a single wave. This creates what's known as a Bose-Einstein condensate, sort of like a mega atom with all the atoms acting as one. What's also freaky physics. Liquid helium cooled below a certain point becomes what's called a superfluid, a fluid that can flow with absolutely no resistance. It can even appear to flow against gravity. Magnets that are cooled with liquid helium below about 4 Kelvin become abnormally strong. We often use these super cool superconducting magnets in MRI machines. These supermagnets are also important for running particle accelerators, the only place where scientists can recreate the super hot temperatures seen in the early universe. At places like CERN, scientists use giant subterranean magnetic racetracks, some up to 16.6 miles long, to smash gold and lead particles together at nearly the speed of light, recreating the conditions of the universe millionths of a second after the Big Bang, when all that existed was a soup of fundamental particles known as quarks and gluons, before they'd cooled enough to create the atoms we know and love today. So far, they've melted particles at temperatures over 5 trillion degrees Celsius, similar to those early conditions. By studying this primordial plasma, scientists can learn about its properties, like how it acts more like a liquid than a gas. So it turns out the laws of physics governing our temperate lives don't always hold in the hottest and coldest conditions. We're learning how fundamental matter behaves differently at the hottest temperatures and discovering new properties in the universe's chillest materials. That's pretty cool. You might even say it's neat. Stay curious. If you want some more super cool physics, you should go watch Physics Girl from our friend Diana, another great channel in the awesome PBS Digital Studios family.
Freaky Physics!